Welcome to the history of WFLI, the early years. This program is dedicated to Cyril Brennan and to the memory of William Billy Benz and his mother, Irley Benz, who played such a special role in putting WFLI on the air and to all Chattanooga area broadcasters, both past and present. Thanks to all the former DJs and staff of WFLI who made JET-FLI so special in the 60s and 70s. We also thank those friends who shared their stories about WFLI. And a special thanks to Ying Benz for making the history of WFLI the early years possible. This program written, edited, and produced by Ben Cagle and Johnny Eagle. All rights reserved.
December of 1960 ended as another mundane, lackluster year in Chattanooga radio. In January of 1961, the final plans were being formulated for a new radio station to serve the Chattanooga area. That new radio station was WFLI, and for many, after February 20th, 1961, things would never be the same. WFLI 1070 AM was on the air.
Serving greater Chattanooga and the Mid-South from Lookout Mountain, Tennessee, JET-FLI WFLI. And now, on we go with a musical show on Down Beat, 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 Beat,
Well,
beat,
beat. You know you make me wanna shout, kick my heels up and shout, throw my hands up and shout.
Station owner Billy Benn saw an emerging trend grow year after year, and he wanted to be a part of it. This relatively new thing called rock and roll was a baby boom bonanza that Elvis Presley had already tapped into.
Well, sir, I've been very lucky. And I happened to come along at a time in the music business where there was no trend. The people were looking for something different, and I was lucky. I came along just in time.
WFLI was an overnight rating success, positioning itself as a Chattanooga radio contender. A few weeks later, Johnny Eagle came on board, and a short time later, he was named station manager. With Johnny Eagle and his flock of young, eager DJs, the rock and roll banner was firmly anchored in Chattanooga's rich radio history.
It's been a
WFLI soared high in Chattanooga's radio ratings, sailing into a lofty, permanent place in the minds of all who witnessed this fast-moving phenomenon. I'm Ben Cagle. Stay tuned. Some of these broadcast legends will be recalling events of the glory days of Chattanooga radio. People still remember the name Dale Anthony, Tommy Jett, Johnny Eagle, Niccolo Niccolo, Mike King, Ron Daly, Ringo Van, and many more. And you'll be hearing from some of them on this show. This program is dedicated to the warm memories that still remain over 50 years later of a time in Chattanooga broadcasting that'll never be replicated. WFLI 1070 AM is on the air. WFLI's Ron Daly.
Remember when James Brown would come to Chattanooga?
Oh, yeah.
Tommy would always be the one invited out to the hotel to talk to him.
And meals later at, what's that restaurant down on MLK, Lamar?
I can't remember now, but I was always invited down to spend time with James Brown, the Fiestas, and Sam Cooke, and Little Willie John, and all those guys, you know, because I had the black audience at night with the night train. Whose idea was it to do the night train? I was the first one.
I really don't remember, Tommy.
The Budweiser night train, you know, Anheuser-Busch.
Is it true that you guys gave away beer at one time?
Yeah.
It was legal to do that.
Exactly. I drank beer on the air. You know, I would open a beer and drink it on the air.
Why do you think he says hey now for?
Exactly. We did things innocently that we didn't know that we couldn't do. We just did them, you know. know, we probably
broke several laws.
We probably did. Yeah, I'd say we broke several laws.
Wait, no, I said wrote them. Not
oh, wrote them. Oh, yeah, we wrote them, too.
When I first came into Chattanooga, Johnny, I remember this very well. I was so impressed with Tommy's car because he had his name on the side of it.
Remember that? Him and Dale Anthony.
Yeah.
Had Dr. his Dale name. On the wing.
What, yeah. What was your slogan on there?
Tommy Jet, WFLI Radio News.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't even read.
You never did the news.
I never did the news. Back then we did a spot summary, didn't we, Johnny?
Yeah.
Just a brief little spot summary.
It was headline.
I remember thinking, that is so cool to have your name on your car like that.
Didn't you really, the call letters.
Yeah.
Well, I wanted to make sure everybody knew who I was, you know.
We were one of the first radio stations that had our own meteorologist.
Yeah, we
His
did.
His name was Peter Jeter, the cross-eyed meteorologist.
Yeah, and you know who came up with that?
Yeah, Stevens, not Stevens.
Johnny Midnight.
And he was something else, wasn't he?
Remember the time that Johnny Midnight had a problem?
And Mr.
Benz had the meeting, and maybe Johnny called the meeting. But what they did, they put him on a different shift since he had had a problem.
Yeah, I sat in for him.
And they said, instead of calling you Johnny Midnight, we'll just call you Johnny Daylight.
Without a warning, you broke my heart.
The WFLI traffic signal is now yellow. Roads are wet and dangerous in the Chattanooga area. Drive with care.
WFLI's most requested song in 1961 was also the number one song in America for 1961. A newcomer named Bobby Lewis.
I couldn't sleep at all last night.
'61 was the beginning year of friendship for many WFLI employees. Friendships that have lasted a lifetime. WFLI's Ringo Vann.
It was the first JET-FLI Spectacular, I believe.
1965.
I think it was the first one.
1965.
And you'd been sick. I was doing your show that on the afternoon, whatever. But who was the lady that lived next door that did the cleaning of the station? Doolin?
Ms. Doolin
was the, and her family, but primarily Ms. Doolin, would come in there every day to sweep the floors and clean the place up and come into the newsroom and clean out everything and was a part of the family.
Yeah. Knocked the arm off the turntable.
Yeah, Tommy would always get upset when she'd come in when he was on the air.
Everybody else
didn't care, but Tommy would get all upset when Ms. Doolin would come when he was on the air.
Yeah.
But, So Johnny had these blazers. It was a trade out from the Coke company up in Cleveland. Hardwick, yeah.
Jimmy Outlaw.
And had a WFLI.
Law, not Outlaw.
That's true. Jimmy what? What
Outlaw. Was it?
Jimmy Law. Jimmy Law.
Anyway, it was a nice red blazer, had WFLI number one on it, that all the jocks were going to wear to the first JET-FLI Spectacular, where we came out on stage and introduced different stars. And Johnny called me and said on a Friday before the first show that afternoon, and said, come on over and get your jacket. I didn't know I was going to get one, so I come out to the station to get my blazer, and Dale, bless his heart, is standing around in the lobby, and Johnny comes out and gives me my blazer, and I'm appreciative of it.
Yeah.
And he said, Johnny, you're giving Ringo Vann a part-time guy a blazer? And Johnny said, well, yeah. And Dale said, well, I guess you're going to give Ms. Doolin one, too, aren't you?
Dr. Dale.
Yeah, Dr. Dale.
Dr. Dale Anthony.
Upset him, didn't it?
Yeah, they got him.
I didn't have a pot to pee in. That blazer kept me warm all winter long.
You're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years. In 1961, President Kennedy created the Peace Corps. F. FCC Chairman Newton Minow claimed that television is a vast wasteland. Navy Commander Alan Shepard blasted into space. Ray Kroc buys out the McDonald Brothers. The yo-yo is the newest craze. And Patsy Cline is burning up the WFLI request line.
Crazy, I'm crazy for feeling so lonely.
It was one hit after another on WFLI as a young singer named Del Shannon zoomed to the top of the charts.
I'm a walking in the rain. Tears are falling and I feel a pain.
1961 was shaping up to be a great year to be in the music business for WFLI. That same year, a group of high school kids from Inkster, Michigan formed a girl group. They had the first number one pop hit released on a black-owned, black-operated record label. The company was Motown, and the group, the Marvelettes.
Oh, yes, wait a minute, Mr. Boatman. Wait, hey, 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 Mr. Boatman.
Hey, Mr. Boatman, look at me.
The WFLI traffic signal is now green. Driving conditions are now normal in greater Chattanooga. Drive with care.
WFLI's Tommy Jett.
So many things happened at JET-FLI. One involved Ron when we had the lion, Dale. Dale always had a better idea. Did y'all notice that his ideas were always a little bit...
Yeah, they had to be better.
They had to be better.
They wouldn't have been
and one day, one morning, I guess, because he did mornings, he was going to rip and read or whatever it was he did in the mornings, and there was a story on AP, I think, wasn't it, Johnny, about a lioness in Birmingham, a radio station.
Like that. Uh-huh.
Yeah, DXB had a lion for a mascot at one time, and so Dale thought it would be a great idea if we were to get a lion as a mascot, and so he rips this off the wire service, and I guess by then Johnny was you were program director by then, weren't you?
I think so.
Yeah, and gives it to Johnny, and next thing you know, Billy Warren. Drove down and got that lioness.
In Birmingham.
In Birmingham, yeah. And brought it back. And
we bought a special station wagon.
Yeah.
I remember that.
I remember that. Wire cage in the
middle. Had the call letters written all over it. So later, if you were in high school and you could guess the number of call letters written on that vehicle, you'd be the winner.
Yeah.
What would you win?
The car.
Mr. Benz would take the lion around himself. If you rode with him, he would make sure he got some hamburger meat or something, and he'd stick it behind the passenger seat, and that lion go nuts.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
This is David Carroll, and my life with WFLI started when I was just a wee toddler. My big sisters used to listen to it in the 60s, the glory days. And the first time I got to actually experience FLI was the day they went 50,000 watts. It was my 11th birthday in 1967. They had a big celebration on a Sunday. I convinced my parents to drop me off and visit Rick Shaw and Ringo Van. They were giving away free records. A couple of years later, I really started listening to the radio. I would hear Dale and Rick and Nick and Mike Murray and Tommy Jett on the weekends. I saw a TV commercial for FLI, and it looked like they were all having such great fun, so it became my goal to work there. So finally, when I was a teenager in 1975, I did get to work there, and I was working nights and evenings. I got to experience the power change on that massive transmitter, took some fun rides, adventurous rides with Mr. Benz and his dog, King, and made some friendships that last to this day. So, from David Carroll, let me just say, long live the great JET-FLI.
WFLI time at the chime. Right now, Chattanooga, I have exactly 29 till 8. If you're driving in the greater Chattanooga area, join in with WFLI, the Tennessee Highway Patrol, Chief Green of the Lookout Mountain Police Department, and the city officials. Urge your neighbor there to drive with care.
The year 1962 marked the beginning of the Cuban Missile Crisis. President Kennedy addresses the nation in a televised speech announcing the presence of offensive missile sites in Cuba.
I call upon Chairman Khrushchev to halt and eliminate this clandestine, reckless, and provocative threat to world peace and to stable relations between our two nations. I call upon him further to abandon this this course of world domination and to join in an historic effort to end the perilous arms race and to transform the history of man. He has an opportunity now to move the world back from the abyss of destruction.
In October of 1962, the USSR begins dismantling Soviet missile silos in Cuba. That same year, Marilyn Monroe dies from an apparent overdose of sleeping pills. John H. Glenn Jr. becomes the first American to orbit the Earth, and Johnny Carson starts his journey on The Tonight Show. The number one requested song on WFLI in 1962 was A Change of Pace, Acker Bilk, and Stranger on the Shore. Listening to the history of WFLI, the early years. In 1962, the Beatles were rejected by Decca Records, telling the group that guitar groups were on the way out. And the painful words from Decca management, the Beatles have no future in show business. It was considered one of the biggest mistakes in music history. It would be two more years before Beatlemania would hit America. But in October of 1962, the Beatles released their first song. WFLI's Tommy Jett.
We had a lot of fun back in those days, didn't we? Yeah. I remember one of my favorite stories that I tell on Ron is he sold a promotion to, a shoe company. What was the name of the shoe?
I don't remember. Yeah. Tom McCann, maybe.
Tom McCann. That was it. Had so much going on. Tom McCann Shoe had a promotion, and Ron was going to walk from the city limits of Chattanooga to Cleveland, Tennessee, in Tom McCann Shoes. And you know about
that. Had other volunteers to walk along.
Yeah, volunteers to walk along with you.
But you played an important role.
I did.
The beginning of the walk-a-thons.
Yeah.
That's it.
And you know what it's like to break in a new pair of shoes. And we're not downing Tom McCann Shoes by any stretch of the mat, you know. But they were brand new shoes, and Ron was going to show everybody how comfortable it was to walk in a pair of Tom McCann shoes.
But we had a plan.
We had a plan. That's right. That they took pictures of him with the Tom McCann shoes. I think the press was there, TV or whatever, and took pictures of him starting out the walk with Tom McCann shoes. Then I was supposed to come along with tennis shoes, and bring him a pair of comfortable tennis shoes.
In case there was any pain along the way, right. That'd be a solution.
and I
guess
was...
Guess who forgot to come along.
Guess who forgot to come along. I probably had been out partying all night that night, and I may have been hungover. I don't know what I was, but I didn't get there.
He sure meant to bring those shoes.
I meant to bring them, but I didn't. I don't think I got there until about the. And when I did get there, Ron was walking on his ankles.
Oh man!
I mean, he was his feet had already turned.
Thanks to a couple of Marine recruiters, I remember it well. They helped me get into Cleveland, Tennessee,
exactly.
And actually complete the walk.
Yeah, Paul Allen and Pete Peterson.
It was the offer of a new pair of shoes that got him in the Marines.
I'm Ringo Vann, the Music Man, and you're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years.
Serving Greater Chattanooga and the Mid-South from Lookout Mountain, Tennessee, JET-FLI WFLI. And now on we go with a musical show on Down Beat, 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 Beat.
One of the most requested songs on WFLI in 1962 was a newcomer named Bobby Vinton.
The roses are red, my love. Violets are blue. Sugar is sweet, my love, but not as sweet.
as you.
Time to reminisce. A great gold record hit at WFLI.
I used to play around with hearts, hasten at my call.
Now, here's a view from the JET-FLI Weather Eye.
The weather forecast for the greater Chattanooga area goes like this. Cloudy to partly cloudy and cooler today and tonight, Wednesday, with occasional light rain today. I'm all mixed up this morning. Everybody hold tight. Thursday, partly cloudy and warmer. High today, 87. Tonight, low 66. High tomorrow, 89. The current temperature right now is 70 degrees in greater Chattanooga. 70 degrees. Ron Daly, come in here.
William Edward Alley, professional gambler who's admitted being in the illicit narcotics trade in recent years, faces a mandatory sentence from 2 to 10 years in prison. Hear all that's news on WFLI coming up at 7:55.
25 to 8 is WFLI time at the chime.
For fun.
For food.
For friends.
Whatever you do, take along too.
Take two, take two.
Cartons of Coke.
Take two, take two.
Only Coca-Cola gives you that refreshing new feeling.
Take along too.
Take two, take two.
Cartons of Coke.
If your plans include two couples or more, you need two cartons more. So whatever you do, take along two cartons of Coke in the king size. Make sure you always have enough Coca-Cola to go around. This news presented by American National Bank over WFLI. 10,000 watts of selling power.
WFLI's Tommy Jett.
Johnny told Rick to go out and introduce Leslie Gore, and he went out and hugged her and got to talking to her about her college days at wherever she was going to college. And
so what's your point?
My point is that you were killing too. My point is that you were killing too much time with your personal situation rather than introducing Leslie Gore to sing the song.
You know, a man's got to do what he's got to do.
Yeah, I know it, and you did what you had to do.
It didn't do any good. You understand?
Johnny was, I must say this, because Dale and myself and a lot of the disc jockeys back then weren't walking the straight and narrow. You know, we were kind of in the middle. So, and Johnny was the one.
Are you about to tell us something we don't know?
No, I'm trying to beat around the bush a little bit and make it as clean as I possibly can. But Johnny was the one who had to keep everybody straight and everybody halfway, you know, composed and walking the straight.
We didn't realize at the time what a job that Johnny had.
No, we didn't. Oh, I appreciate it now, but then I didn't really realize what a job he had of staying sober mainly and keeping things straight, you know. And so we kept him busy doing that, and Rick would introduce somebody, and then Dale would introduce somebody, and I would come out and introduce. We all had our own little thing going, you know. But the JET-FLI Spectaculars, I think, were something that made one of the biggest impressions in radio in the Chattanooga market ever in the history of broadcasting, really.
I'm Ben Cagle, and you're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years. In 1962, Motown was red hot and getting hotter with a new artist named Mary Well.
A great gold record hit at WFLI.
My boomerang won't come back.
When this old world starts getting me down, and people are just too much for me to face.
1962 was a great year at WFLI in ratings and sales, and arguably many people feel that 1962 was the beginning of rock and roll's greatest 8 years.
Oh, well,
WFLI traffic signal is now yellow. Roads are wet and dangerous in the Chattanooga area. Drive with care.
Say, if you want that little girl to love you when you first start off, what you gotta do is to look sharp. And the way you look sharp, you use the lather blade razor method of shaving by Gillette. Of course, everybody knows that. You know, Gillette Super Blue Blades are double edge. They give you double economy, double life. Yes, two of these smooth shaving edges on every Super Blue Blade, they fit any Gillette razor. And I'm telling you, there's something else. Boys, you gotta shave with Gillette. It's a swinging way. It's what's happening, as Tommy Jett would say.
Oh yeah, that's signed in by my close personal friend Dion DiMucci.
Everybody's your close personal friend, TJ. have you ever known anybody that did not have so many close personal friends?
That's right. I've got to say this, Tommy. In school, Tommy always stood out. He was always a little different, always had something going on. You knew when rock and roll came out, he was going to be a star. You knew he'd be remembered anywhere he'd go. You always have been. Now, let's go back to that story we started to tell before the phone call started coming in.
Let's get the story.
Do you remember being at the Bears Den drive-in restaurant?
I do, and I didn't want
to. In July, where we're celebrating Christmas in July. And Tommy was dressed as Santa's helper.
Right, yeah.
A thin Santa's helper.
About 140 pounds, yeah. I didn't want to do that.
People lined up that night.
I know they did. You pulled that one off beautifully.
Man. Every holiday season, they're remembering you now.
Yeah. And the other one that you pulled off was the one at W.T. Grant's. You know, that was a...
Yeah, one time we lined up a promotion. This was just a fun thing because we said Tommy could take a vacation anywhere he wanted to.
Right.
He could go to the Bahamas. He could go to wherever.
Yeah.
But he chose W.T. Grant's. That's when they were open, right?
When there was.
They closed.
When there was a W.T. Grant's.
I don't know if we helped him or hurt him. Sure. But anyway, we had a promotion.
I think you should have gone to the Bahamas.
Had a promotion there, and Tommy had his leisure clothes on. He had a
leisure suit on.
Right? Yeah. And had a fishbowl with a fishing pole and suitcases, and lived there in the store for a while. I think they got used to you being there.
I lived there a week. Lived there a whole week. Yeah.
Free rent, got used to you being there.
Did you broadcast from there? Was it a remote?
We broadcast
another time. Tommy rode, I've got to tell this story, Tommy. You rode to Athens, Tennessee.
Oh, Lord.
To what was then the Cherokee drive-in restaurant in Athens, Tennessee. You rode a bike up there.
A bicycle, yeah.
Maybe Nick Smith rode with you.
David Carroll
Stanley
has a
Hall.
In his book. David has a picture of that in his book, I think.
Does he?
I think so.
Yeah. Stanley Hall, remember that?
Yes,
we were all up there on a promotion, and we had the listeners guess how long it would take for the arrival, and then they won prizes.
That's true, yeah.
But you made it. You actually lived through that.
And it poured down rain the second day. We rode to Cleveland, Tennessee, and spent the night in Cleveland. And got up the next morning and then went on to Athens, Tennessee, to the Cherokee drive-in restaurant in Athens.
The same company owned the Bears Den in Cleveland.
Yeah.
So it was a lot of fun. And that's one thing that Johnny and the folks at JET-FLI would let you do. They let you promote and have a little fun.
Exactly.
In the news on WFLI, the Cuban Missile Crisis was weeks behind us. The year 1963 started with hope and heartbreak, ripe with promise and scarred by tragic endings. Alabama Governor George Wallace.
And I say segregation now, segregation tomorrow, and segregation forever.
1963 was the beginning of a dream. Heartbreak struck America on November 22, 1963, when President John F. Kennedy was assassinated in Dallas, Texas. On the local front, Chattanooga Mayor Ralph Kelly declared all Chattanooga facilities open to all, which officially began Chattanooga's desegregation. One of the most requested songs ever on WFLI was a local Chattanooga group. It was a national hit in 1963, a casual, easygoing soul shuffle, Chattanooga's Impressions. They gave much-needed comfort to a country still reeling from the JFK assassination. They were saying, better days are ahead. It's all right.
Say it's all right.
It's all right.
Now give yourself a chance.
WFLI former competitor Jerry Linger at WDXV remembers well when WFLI went on the air in 1961, forcing a format change at WDXV. Jerry Lingerfeld is retired general manager of WTVC Television in Chattanooga.
Radio in Chattanooga before JET-FLI. There were six radio stations I remember: WDEF, DOD, APO, AGC, NOO, and WDXB. Also, there was a station in South Pittsburgh where Rick Govan came from, and two stations in Cleveland. There was one FM station in Chattanooga, WLOM on Lookout Mountain, played mostly classical music. FM hadn't hit the auto market yet. There were network programs like Don McNeil's Breakfast Club, the old redhead Arthur Godfrey. The soaps were still on radio. And the local guys that were popular were Luther, Harry Thornton, Peanut Faircloth, who played country music. And a popular guy on what we call the colored radio station back then was Dave the Rave Oliver, the mayor of Big Nine. He played those rhythm and blues songs. They were just a daytimer. TV came to Chattanooga, Channel 12 in 54, Channel 3 in 55, and Channel 9 in 58. Local names that I remember back then were Hal Siegel and Siegel's Beagles, Ernie Fagans and Fagan's Follies. Gus Chamberlain did all the Chattanooga Lookouts baseball games. Larry Johnson came to WDOD in 1955 and played a version of a rhythm and blues and rock and roll.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're going to rock around the clock tonight. Put your glad rags on. Join me, huh?
Rock and roll was born and given its name by Alan Freed in 1956. Elvis came along, and that genre was off and running, and radio stations across America started playing music and news 24 hours a day. Nothing but the top 40 songs. In 1957, WDXV started Chattanooga's first 24-hour-a-day music and news station. First to go 24 hours a day, and first to allow the announcers to sit behind the console and play their own records. At WDXB, the jocks call themselves the Big Five. Bill Sanders, T. Tommy Reynolds, later known as Dr. Shock, Lloyd Payne, Jim the Weird Beard Small, and some kid from Chattanooga just out of the Tennessee School of Broadcasting who they named Jerry Linger. He went on the air for the first time from midnight to 6 a.m. WDXB was rolling right along very well until some genius engineer out of Alabama named Billy Benz came into town in the dark of the night and figured out how to put a 10,000-watt radio station on the air in Chattanooga. And in 1961, JET-FLI came on the air with Down Beat, 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 Beat.
Serving greater Chattanooga and the Mid-South from Lookout Mountain, Tennessee, JET-FLI WFLI. And now, on we go with a musical show on Down Beat, 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 Beat.
And in about 6 months from then, coming on the air, that little 1,000-watt WDXB changed its format to Sweet and Lively. And the hot names in Chattanooga radio, other than Luther, were Dale Anthony, Johnny Eagle, Tommy Jett, Rick Govan, William Stanley Hall, and others. And JET-FLI was off and running. And now, you know the rest of the story. And by the way, that Jerry Linger fellow went to work for WDEF in 1967 as Luther's official food taster.
Now, here's a view from the JET-FLI Weather Eye.
Clear to partly cloudy and a little bit warmer today, tonight, and tomorrow, with a high today 94 degrees, a low tonight 66, and a high for tomorrow 95 degrees. And outside we're reading 90 swinging degrees.
Lookout Mountain plays an important part in making Tennessee one of the nation's greatest vacation lands. Remember, a visit to Lookout Mountain makes any vacation or outing a complete success.
From WFLI's Hall of Fame.
The one who taught her to kiss.
I'm Ben Cagle, and you're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years. The year 1963 produced some of the best music in radio, classics that would last a lifetime.
She wore blue velvet.
Hey, hey, Paula, I want to marry you.
Donna, Donna, the prima donna, 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 the prima donna.
One fine day, you're gonna want me for your girl.
In dreams, I walk with you.
Our day will come, and we'll have everything.
WFLI traffic signal is now red. Police report there has been an accident in the greater Chattanooga area. If you are driving, you are urged to use extreme caution. Be on the lookout for emergency vehicles. The WFLI traffic signal is now red.
JET-FLI chime time, 29 before 2.
At one time or another, all of us have used the installment plan. See Household Finance.
Never borrow money needlessly, but when you must, borrow with a purpose from HFC, the name to trust. Borrow confidently from HFC.
HFC makes loans up to $2,500 with up to 36 months to repay. Visit the new HFC of Chattanooga, located at 838 Market Street, corner of Market and 9th. Phone 265-0211.
Beard Walters.
Beard Walters.
Simon Ford. Beard Walters Ford. Drive a little, save a lot at Beard Walters Ford.
Dayton, Tennessee.
Hi there, Del Anthony for Jack's Music Shop. At Jack's Music Shop, 14 East 9th Street, between Market and Cherry, you'll find rock and roll, rhythm and blues, country and western, gospel. How about oldies? Would you like to have some oldies? If they don't have them at Jack's Music Shop, they will order them for you. You might like to have, you can get it at Jack's Music Shop, 14th East 9th Street between Market and Cherry. When you go in, tell them Dale Anthony sought you by from the Big Bad Fly.
WFLI's Johnny Eagle talks about the name change.
There are so many memories about Mr. Benz, but I guess the story, the one thing that, how Johnny Eagle was born, by that I mean how Johnny Eagle come to be, because when I first joined WFLI, my name was Johnny D. And I was on the air one afternoon, and Mr. Benz came into control room and asked me if I had a problem changing my last name to Eagle. And I said, well, Johnny Eagle does have a nice ring, don't it, Mr. Benz? And the record ended, and Johnny Eagle came alive right then.
This is WFLI Jets Stream News. From every point in the universe comes WFLI Instant News.
Johnny Eagle with this edition of WFLI Instant News.
WFLI's Gene Lovin.
Reflecting back and looking at the many radio stations that I had worked at, a few before WFLI and many after JET-FLI. JET-FLI was probably the radio station that stands out among all of them. I've been very blessed in working in some larger markets, including Atlanta and Greensboro and West Palm Beach and Huntsville. But Johnny Eagle and the staff at JET-FLI, at WFLI, was one of the most, enduring staffs that I had ever worked with. We were genuinely friends. We all got along together. There was promotions that we did with the Harlem Globetrotters. There was, of course, the big JET-FLI spectaculars. Everybody was included. Everybody was treated equally. And you have to have leadership in that ability. And I know that Johnny was on the air many years earlier, but my experience with Johnny Eagle as a station manager was just, tremendous. So he's just one wonderful person.
Get it together right now. I mean, you're right this minute. It's 16 minutes after 1 o'clock. Saturdays are solid gold on an instant rip-off weekend. Rip off the Flag Guys for top-selling LPs. The LP by Aretha Franklin to be given away sometime this hour. Meanwhile, the satisfaction of the Stones. Who dedicates that record to our general manager, Johnny Eagle, Johnny B. Good, Chuck Berry, 17 away from 2. Saturdays, solid gold. Instant rip-off weekend with Love It. Bob Dylan, solid gold, like a rolling stone. WFLI is like a rolling stone.
Like a rolling stone.
A complete unknown. It's Bob Dylan.
Goonie Golf presents a capsule tour of the fabulous, inimitable Goonie Golf Course, a presentation of Goonie Golf, the fun game for the entire family. Now, here to personally conduct you on an exclusive audio tour of the incomparable Goonie Golf Course, your host and great proponent of Goonie Golf, that outstanding sports figure, and...
Sorry, Steve, but the spot's over.
Stay tuned!
You get a lot to like with a Marlboro filter, flavor, flip-top box. Filter, flavor, flip-top box.
WFLI on time, the time, and now it's 8:05. This is WFLI, 10,000 watts of 24-hour musical downbeat. WFLI, Lookout Mountain, Tennessee.
From our gold record selections at WFLI.
Angel, angel, oh.
This is Niccolo Niccolo, the JET-FLI Lookout Mountaineer, and you're listening to JET-FLI, the early years.
In the news headlines on WFLI in 1964, Nelson Mandela was sentenced to life imprisonment in South Africa. Congress approved the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution after North Vietnamese torpedo boats allegedly attacked U.S. destroyers. Khrushchev is deposed. Brezhnev becomes the first secretary to the Communist Party. The President's Commission on the Assassination of President Kennedy issued the Warren Report, concluding that Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone. Jack Ruby was convicted of murder in the slaying of Lee Harvey Oswald. And in Chattanooga, Chattanooga was in the national news constantly in early 1964 with the jury tampering trial of labor leader Jimmy Hoffa. He was found guilty of attempted bribery and conspiracy. He was sentenced to 8 years in prison. In 1964, it was only 19 years before that Japan and Germany announced their surrender and ceasefire, effectively starting an end to World War II. Ironically, many Americans were still skeptical that America would be invaded. An invasion did come to America in 1964, but it wasn't the Japanese, and it wasn't the German.
Now, yesterday and today, our theater's been jammed with newspapermen and hundreds of photographers from all over the nation, and these veterans agree with me that the city never has witnessed the excitement stirred by these youngsters from Liverpool who call themselves the Beatles. Now, tonight, you're going to twice be entertained by them. Right now, and again in the second half of our show, ladies and gentlemen, the Beatles!
Close your eyes and I'll kiss you. Tomorrow I'll miss you.
Beatlemania was officially here, and from a programming and sales point of view, WFLI was enjoying every moment. WFLI's Mike King remembers well.
I remember when Mr. Benz and Johnny Eagle had Tommy to start the top 8 at 8 at night. And the people would call in during the day, vote on their most favorite song, and the top eight songs would be played back at 8 o'clock at night. And I remember a time when all 8 of them were Beatles songs. And a lot of times, the top 7 would be Beatles songs, and somebody like Elvis would have number 8. But Elvis had ridden supreme for quite a while, and the Beatles just shot him out of the saddle. No doubt about that.
If I give my heart to you, I must...
On April 4th, 1964, the Beatles monopolized the top 5 songs in the nation, according to Billboard magazine. The Beatles are the only act in music history to lock up the top 5. Here they are, the top 5 songs in the nation for the week of April 4th, 1964, starting with number 5.
Come on.
Tommy Jett, and you're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years.
Pretty woman walking down the street.
I don't care what they say, I won't stay in a world without love.
Round, round, get around, I get around, yeah, get around, round, round, I get around, I get around.
One of the most frequent voices heard on commercials in the early years on WFLI was the voice of Stanley Hall Jr., WFLI's undisputed production guru. Gene Lovin remembers.
Some of my fond memories of Stanley Hall was that he was, and I'm sure a lot of people have related lots of stories, but he was a creative genius. He really was. So far ahead of his time, he'd write copy that you hear little tidbits of now that he was doing, you know, some 30 or 40 years ago. But he was a very creative individual, always thinking outside of the box, very creative with local spots. His production and capabilities were major market as well as, agency quality work.
And sometimes when things got slow in the production room, Stanley would just start singing into the microphone.
I want a peanut man for Christmas this year, 'cause that peanut man brings me so much cheer round here. I want that peanut man. You know that peanut man, the man who knows about everything from castle to pistachio. Here I go to see that peanut man. they mean to. You got everything that's a sweet for you. I want a peanut name.
WFLI's Tommy Jett on the late Stanley Hall, Jr.
I later have looked back retrospectively, and I see that Stanley Hall was a genius when it come to being able to produce things in the production room. And that was his mainstay, but he also was a songwriter. He was a singer. Matter of fact, United Artists picked him up on a label, on their label, to do a song called I Want to Be Bobby's Dad, which charted. I don't think it was the number one song, but it did chart.
Bobby's mom and dad never did get along so good. And their fussing was the talk of a neighborhood. Bobby knew they loved each other.
Then, of course, there was Stanley Hall Jr.'s Rodney Ripoff.
Good morning. This is Rodney Ripoff, your early morning report traffic helicopter. Our pilot, Bud Bell, had a few too many last night. He's a little hungover this morning. And I'm going to make a long story short. We're lost. We're over some beautiful terrain out here. We can see a couple of vehicles moving down a secondary highway in an orderly fashion. Those motorists are to drive with care. But unfortunately, I don't know where we are, man, but I'll guarantee you there's traffic out there this morning, man. And, you know, if you're in your car, you know that. If you're at home, you probably know that, unless you just never travel around. And then you need me to tell you that there is traffic about this time every morning. And, in fact, if you didn't know that, you're too stupid to drive a car, man. You know, really. This is Rodney Ripoff, returning you now to the cast of idiots.
The following commercial will give you a little insight into the mind of Stanley Hall Jr. It was a commercial that never aired. It was never intended to air. It was only made out of boredom in the production room. The late Stanley Hall Jr.
New from King Bell, 22 all-time losers. Records you've never heard, never bought, and never thought of. Here are the big bombs of 1976, including... And who could remember... All in all, 22 big bombs. You'll receive this stiff by Harvey Snake.
Wherever he goes, and everyone gets what?
22 all-time losers from the artists who didn't make it big. You'll barf over Sorghum and Sardines by Irma Fark.
Body needs to be loved, and I'm going.
22 terrible turkeys on two low vinyl discs, also available on low oxide tapes. To order, send $13.95 for records, $14.95 for tapes. To 22 terrible turkeys, box 1-883-742, Muscatine, Iowa 90919. That's 22 terrible turkeys, box 1-873-2, Muscatine, Iowa 90919. Save COD charges and don't order. Do it before midnight tonight.
A JET-FLI gold record.
From Ringo's rusty record rack, Ringo remembers.
Took 100 pounds of clay.
54 degrees in Chattanooga, no rain in the fly forecast. Congratulations to Rachel Johnson of 2500 Cummings Highway. Rachel is our news tip winner of last week.
Two Wrigley spearmint gum. Get some soon.
Dale Anthony Showtime, week morning, 6 to 9 on fly.
WFLI.
Cherry, cherry. 17 now before 9 it fly.
I'm JET-FLI. Ringo Band plays the hits.
14 until 9's your fly time. Hit time with the Beach Boys.
Wouldn't it be nice if we were older?
Your Your time now at Fly is 9 minutes before 9 o'clock. Say, would you like to be paid while learning a trade? Well, if you're between 17 and 21 years of age and you have graduated or dropped out of school for a period of 1 year or more, well, this is your chance. You may receive $20 or more per week plus some transportation. Apply for training at the Youth Opportunity Center, 407 Market Street, downtown Chattanooga. Your time now is 8 minutes until 9 o'clock at WFLI News Live at 55. Ringo Van, the Music Man, here on a Friday night. We've got Carla Thompson, everybody, to sing her sound of woe. It's called Baby, B-A-B-Y.
Baby.
Oh, yeah, honey.
Oh, baby.
Oh.
I love to call you baby. I like it. I love it.
Now, Jetstream news from every point in the universe. Instant news from WFLI.
855, Ringo Van, your reporter from McKenzie, Tennessee. A young Paris, Tennessee truck driver. UN Secretary General U Thant has expressed regret over Red China's announced test of a nuclear missile. Test patterns transmitted by COMSAT's new communication satellite are described as excellent.
Now, here's a view from the JET-FLI Weather Eye.
Fair weather with little temperature change through Saturday. No rain in the fly forecast. Low tonight, 35. The high tomorrow, 77. Presently and officially in the Mid-South, the JET-FLI Weather Eye reports a certified 54. That's 54 degrees.
When news breaks out, WFLI breaks in with 24-hour mobile news reports to keep you in touch with the time.
You know what kind of cars they sell at Lowrance Motor Company, Highway 27 and Trenton Road in Lafayette, Georgia?
Those oldies but goodies.
That's right, those good used cars, and they're clean. Check these terrific buys at Lowrance Motor Company. Two 1956 Fords. They're two-door customs, they're V8, they're straight drive, and they're only $4.95. How about a 1956 Ford six-cylinder, straight shift, black, and only $4.95. A 57 Chevy, oh boy, it's a four-door sedan, it's a six, it's got a straight stick, and my goodness, it's only $7.95. You get on-the-spot financing at Lowrance Motor Company. They'll finance your car without a lot of red tape and annoying paperwork. And just a small down payment will let you drive away the car of your choice. So see them today and drive it away. Lowrance Motor Company, Highway 27 and Trenton Road, Lafayette, Georgia.
Hi, everybody. This is Tommy Jett, and I'd like to invite you to the coat of arms this Friday and Saturday night, where you'll see and hear Travis Womack. You'll hear Travis and his big sound scratchy. Admission only $2. Start time on Friday night, 9 till midnight. On Saturday night, it'll be 8:30 until 11:30, and yours truly, TJ, will be your master of ceremonies on Saturday night. Don't miss the big show and dance this Friday and Saturday night at the Coat of Arms, starring Travis Womack. See you there.
Thank you, TJ the DJ. Why not go out and get right on a Friday or Saturday night? Travis Womack at the Coat of Arms in about 14 minutes.
WFLI's Ron Daly and the late Ray Anderson.
I really went to WFLI for sales, as sales. And it was combination people at that time. If you couldn't sell and be a disc jockey, they didn't need you. And
an engineer and a disc jockey.
Yeah, and I know. And if you were an engineer, you were nothing. I mean, like Joe, he was nothing. Now I respect him with all my heart, but
we disagree with him.
Yeah, right. But you had to be a disc jockey and a salesman and a production manager, you know, Mr. Everything. And
Mr. Ben's tried to get his money's worth.
Yeah, right. Well, yeah.
He's a smart businessman.
Well, hey, Mr. Dynamite, you know, Mr. B, Mr. Brochure, you know, that's Mr. Ben's. He is there. He's everything, so he expects everybody else to be everything, I think. I know Ron will recall this, and I want to share this with Ron while he's here, because Ron was going into the Marine Corps, and I was going to work for WFLI, and Ron and I worked together for, what, 3 or 4 weeks, maybe. Yeah. And remember we went to the Sugar and Spice Drive-In restaurant in Cleveland, Tennessee.
He said,
I've been to North Carolina, guys, and he said, I bought me a barbecue machine. And he goes out and he shows it to us, and he says, I want a dynamic commercial. So we go down, and Ron pulls my hair, and I pull his, and then we start pulling our own. We can't come up with nothing. He's overwhelmed our enthusiasm. We just can't think of anything. So Ron turns the microphone. He said, turn the tape on, Ray. And I turned the tape on. He said, barbecue, 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 barbecue at the Sugar and Spice.
We go back
in there a couple days later, and believe me, the guy said, I can't believe it. He said, all I've sold is barbecue. Take it off and put my hamburgers on.
Hi, this is Max O'Brien, and you're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years.
In the national news on WFLI in 1965, President Lyndon Johnson declares,
I believe that we can continue the great society while we fight in Vietnam.
The first combat troops arrive in Vietnam. It's met with resistance.
Demonstrators must depart from the Pentagon grounds by midnight. All persons who wish to leave voluntarily can board buses on the road.
In other news, in 1965, France withdraws its native fleet from NATO. Rhodesia declares independence from Britain. Dr. Martin Luther King is arrested in Selma, Alabama on voter registration rules. Blacks riot for 6 days in Los Angeles. 34 dead, 1,000 injured, and 4,000 arrested. One of the biggest local stories on WFLI in 1965, a Chattanooga obstetrician, Robert Demas, was held hostage at gunpoint by a bank robber during a wild 100-mile-an-hour ride through North Georgia. He disarmed his captor as police moved in. Dr. Demas later said, I'm no hero. All I did was drive 100 miles an hour with a gun at my head and grabbed it when I got the chance.
This is Ralph Vaughn in Murfreesboro. As president of the Tennessee Radio Hall of Fame, I commend and congratulate all those involved with producing the historical tribute to WFLI in Chattanooga, one of the trailblazing radio stations in our great state. I personally have fond memories of WFLI going back to 1965 when I was a starry-eyed teenager living in Smithville. I had an affinity for WFLI for several reasons. I was beginning my own fledgling intro of a dream that had consumed my mind for 11 years. You see, I had dreamed of being a radio announcer since the age of 6. With that mindset, and on a good day, weather-wise, my car radio would capture the best music for my generation from Lookout Mountain, Tennessee. And for me personally, there were 3 cool DJs who called Smithville their roots: Dale Anthony, Nick Smith, and Tommy Jett. They were an important part of my zeal for radio. Now that I'm retired from radio broadcasting, I have time to reflect and almost feel the same emotions that I did back in 1965. Being involved with the Tennessee Radio Hall of Fame provides me an opportunity to join other broadcasters across the state to help preserve and perpetuate the legacy or the importance of radio in almost every community from Mountain City to Memphis. What would any community be without radio? And what would the Mid-South be without the memories of WFLI radio? Thanks for the memories. WFLI, you helped to change my life, and I am thankful.
Now, here's a view from the JET-FLI Weather Eye. It's going to be partly cloudy to cloudy and mild tonight and tomorrow with a chance of sunny showers. The low tonight 70, the high for tomorrow 85, and presently Chattanooga, you can believe it, it's 86 JET-FLI tide degrees.
1965, the most requested song on WFLI goes to the Rolling Stones. WFLI's Johnny Eagle talked about scheduling problems on one of the JET-FLI spectaculars.
Well, the second time that we ever had Paul Revere and the Raiders come to town, because we had booked them, and I mean we were running up on 2 or 3 days prior to the show. We're having two shows, one at 5:30 and one at 9 o'clock, and then we get a phone call that they're not going to be able to make the show because they were previously booked in Atlanta. Well, this threw us in a panic because we had been advertising they were going to be there for months. Mr. Benz's partner, his brother Bill Brennan, owned Learjet International in Atlanta. So we arranged with him to fly the Paul Revere and the Raiders up here to our show. What they did is they rented some equipment to do their show in Atlanta. They sent their guy, whose name was Hoss, their road manager, up here to bring their equipment on up here. They did their show at 3 o'clock in Atlanta at the merchandise mart down there. They rushed them to the airport, got on the Learjet, flew them up here, and he insisted on going on first. So they were introduced to 5,000 screaming young people first and done their show, got on the plane, flew back to Atlanta, did their show at 8 o'clock, got on the plane again and flew back to Chattanooga. And it was probably close to 11 o'clock. When they got on the air, when they got on the stage here. So they did four shows that day, but Paul made the comment he'd never do that again. Girl, you be so mad. Just need you help, girl. Out. It's too late, girl. You better get straight. Don't it seem like kids just keep getting hotter? Oh, than you don't and need kids, girl. WFLI's most requested songs in 1965.
Help, I need somebody. Help, not just anybody.
Help, you lost that love and feeling. Whoa, that love and feeling.
I've got sunshine on a cloudy day.
Uno, dos, one, two, tres, cuatro.
I'm Ben Cagle, and you're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years. Over 50 years later, it's always a party when the remaining Fly guys get together.
One of the great things Johnny did was selecting the music.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah.
I wasn't the only one.
Well, yeah, he had a certain order that you had to play the music in. Yeah. I think a lot of the listeners might not have known that.
A, B, C, and then Go Record, DEF, Hall of Fame.
When we first started at Fly, before Johnny became program director, though, we used to have music meetings. Was that a picture of the...
Yeah, it's not for you, Tom.
Oh, no.
No, you get your own, Tommy.
We had meetings, music meetings, where Mrs. Benz would attend, and Johnny and Dale and I, and we would pick out, didn't you remember those meetings?
Oh, yeah.
Matter of fact, we had them on Tuesday, every Tuesday.
Yeah.
We had the meetings, and so.
Records changed every week.
Yeah, you had to fill out a little.
One or two records would change in the system every
exactly.
week.
Exactly. Mr. Benz kept a list of that and could tell you exactly what song.
Well, you had to play them in order.
Had to play them in order.
You had to play them in order.
Yeah.
You couldn't just pick at random.
Did you move back in the room?
I lived at the radio station for a while. We had a little apartment. Talk about small. I mean, it was like a, you know, closet.
Yeah, a bedroom and a bathroom. Yeah. Yeah, I lived there for 2 years.
You lived there for 2 years, yeah. And I lived there a while.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
But, it was an interesting station, to say the least. We would have more people coming. Johnny, elaborate on this. You know, Tommy would be on the air. More girls would come out there. All of us were single, you know, and all these people would be coming out to the radio station. How did you put up with that crowd?
I don't know.
Coming to Chattanooga's Memorial Auditorium Friday, December 9th.
The WFLI Winter Spectacular.
This will be the greatest WFLI show ever.
With two great performances at 6 and 9 p.m.
Starring the Birds. Plus Sandy Posey. The Newbies. Billy Joe Royal. And Roy Orbison. Also, David Houston. The McCoys. Luke Christie. And Sam the Sham and the Pharaohs. Extra added question mark and the Mysterians.
2 minute teardrops.
Write tickets, WFLI O'Grady Drive, Chattanooga, Tennessee.
Send $250 for reserve section, $2 for general admission.
Please enclose a self-addressed stamped envelope and indicate which show you want to see, 6 or 9 p.m.
That's Friday, December 9th, the WFLI Winter Spectacular.
Listen to JET-FLI for more details.
You're gonna crack.
It's Dan Flinor's Hurricane Hail Drivers at the Cleveland Speedway, Wednesday, June 20th. 2 hours of smashing, crashing thrills in 1962 Dodge Lancers. See these motor maniacs perform a 75-foot ramp-to-ramp leap.
See the sensational dive bomber crash.
And the deliberate crash roll contest and stock automobile.
A motorcycle firewall crash. On the raceway, directly in front of the stands,
it's Dan Flinor's Hurricane Hail Drivers.
At the Cleveland Speedway, one night only, Wednesday, June 20th.
Admission for adults, $1.50, children, 50 cents.
Don't miss it! Dan Flinor's Hurricane Hail Drivers at the Cleveland Speedway.
You'll see it from the edge of your seat.
Remember now, one night only, June 20th, 8:30 p.m.
JET-FLI time at the chime. Right now it's 13 past 8.
The WFLI traffic signal is now green. Driving conditions are now normal in greater Chattanooga. Drive with care.
So fine. So fine.
WFLI's Tommy Jett.
I would book various artists into National Guard armories and nightclubs and things of that nature. So the Fiestas come in, and B.J. Jones called me and said, "Hey, man, I got a group here that's had a hot song out, So Fine, and would you be interested in booking them?" And I said, "Yeah, you doggone right I would." So they drove out to the station, had a white Cadillac. And a white Cadillac convertible. And they drove out to the station, and I got to know them and had them on the air with me, and called the National Guard Armory in Dalton, Georgia, and got them booked, and they were able to perform, but no blacks were able to come to the show. We packed it out, had a packed house, and when they would come into town, we became friends, and I stayed in touch with them periodically after they would leave town. I'd call them and just shoot the breeze with them from time to time. And even when they would come back into town, I would have to make arrangements with Joe Dara down at Chow Time to feed them. And I'd say, "Joe, I have four black guys, singers, in town, and they need a place to eat." He'd say, "Well, send them down. I'll send a curb girl out, and she can take their order. We'll put it on your tab." And the only two places they could stay in Chattanooga was the Rosetta Motel, which was predominantly, well, it was a black motel where that happened. And the other place was the Park View Hotel downtown on 9th Street, right across from Brad's restaurant. So a lot of times after a show, we would head for Brad's, and I'd be the only white guy in the crowd.
Here's a group that had a top 10 record in the nation.
In the nation.
And
right.
They're unable to stay at a motel in Chattanooga.
Exactly. Exactly right.
Cupid, draw back your bow.
Tell me about Sam Cooke.
Sam Cooke, I met with Dion, and Jimmy Harris was with me, and I had a Wallensack tape recorder, and Sam, I got Sam to record some promos for me, saying, "Hi, this is Sam Cooke, you're Jet with my main man Tommy Jet on JET-FLI," and of course Dion did too. And I had a nice visit with him and did the show at the Memorial Auditorium. I wasn't on the show. I didn't go on stage because that wasn't permissible either, really. It was a black show. And Jimmy Harris and I were the only two white people at the auditorium backstage. And we had access to Sam Cooke and also Dion. And that was one of, and later that same night, we had dinner with Dion, because he could go to the Old South restaurant on Broad Street. Sam couldn't go.
Now, Cupid, don't you hear me calling you? I need you, Cupid.
In the national news on WFLI in 1966, North Vietnamese arms and men move southward along the Ho Chi Minh Trail. U.S. bombing strikes escalate as the war rages in Vietnam. Gemini 8, with Neil Armstrong and David Scott aboard, tumbles briefly out of control in space before returning home safely. Hollywood film star Ronald Reagan captures the Republican gubernatorial nomination in June and is elected California's new governor in November. The nation is shocked when Richard Speck commits mass murder in Chicago and Charles Whitman shoots 13 people to death in Austin, Texas. In 1966, hundreds of young men from the Chattanooga area continued to be drafted and sent to Vietnam. Also in 1966, the Chattanooga Police Department was adjusting to the new Supreme Court Miranda ruling, which required suspects be told their rights to legal counsel, and they did not have to answer questions.
Hi, this is Nick Smith, and you're listening to WFLI, The Early Years.
The number one requested song on WFLI in 1966 goes to the Four Tops and Reach Out.
Now if you feel that you can't go on, because all of your hope is gone, just look over your shoulder.
WFLI's David Carroll remembers an encounter with WFLI owner Billy Benz.
I was on FLI afternoons from 2 to 6 o'clock. I was about 18, and thank goodness I got a job there after the era where you had to have a first-class radio telephone operator's license. Some people were smart enough to pass that test. I was not. I was lucky to change a light bulb at that age. I did get my third-class license, and about all I was qualified to do was to read the meters on the transmitter. There were about five different meters that had little numbers and digits and things, and once an hour, the FCC required us to go in at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and so on, and write down those five little meter readings. Took maybe 30 seconds, and then you could go back to playing rock and roll and talking to girls on the phone. And it was only about 10 steps to the transmitter. How easy is that? But like a lot of disc jockeys, that was a lot of trouble to get up out of your chair and tell the girl to hang on, I'll be back, and go in and do that once an hour. So what I would do, right after I got on the air at 2 o'clock, I would walk into the transmitter room, read the meters, and some of them, you know, would vary slightly hour to hour. So if one of them said 3.73 for 2 o'clock, I might write 3.74, 3 o'clock, 3.71 at 4 o'clock. But I would do all this at one time. Just get it out of the way. Do it at 2 o'clock. Be done with it. Never have to worry about it again the rest of the day. And I did that for days and weeks and months. I think the other DJs did it too. So one afternoon, I'm sitting there about 2:55, you know, playing the rock and roll, talking to the girls. In walks Mr. Benz. It's a Friday afternoon. It's payday. He's not a happy man. He's had to sign the paychecks. That was never a joyful chore for him. He walks in the control room unannounced with his big German Shepherd, King. King was bigger than I was. And the first thing he does is grab the clipboard with the meter readings, and he just looks over them, kind of puts the glasses on the bridge of his nose and studies them for about 30 seconds. And I'm sitting there sweating the whole time, hoping he's not really paying close attention or he's you know, reviewing my handwriting or something. And he puts his glasses down and looks at me and says, Mr. Carroll. You know, I was 18 years old, but he called everybody Mr. And I thought that was really, you know, respectful. Mr. Carroll, do you have a crystal ball back there? Excuse me, sir? Can you predict the future, Mr. Carroll? What do you mean, Mr. Benz? Well, I notice it's not even 3 o'clock, and you've already got the meter readings for 4 o'clock and 5 o'clock and 6 o'clock. How do you know what the meters are going to read at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, and 6 o'clock? And I start to, you know, stammer some, well, Mr. Benz, just today I was in a, you know, Mr. Carroll, you realize I could lose my license for this station. Well, of course, Mr. Benz, yes, sir. You realize this could never happen again, right, Mr. Carroll? No, sir, it will never happen again. You're damn right it won't. And then he walks out with King, and I sit there and wipe the sweat off and try to play rock and roll again. But he taught me a lesson. I never did it again, at least under Mr. Benz, and WFLI kept its license.
WFLI's Gene Lovin.
I was working a Friday night playing all the hits, and Mr. Benz came in, and of course, Mr. Benz had a way of telling you something. He would, Mr. Lovin, turn it off. And I said, what do you mean, Mr. Benz? He said, turn the radio, shut it down, turn the radio station off. So I did as Johnny had instructed me to. I turned the transmitter off, and then I called Johnny and said, Mr. Benz had me turn the radio station off. And at that time, he would call Bud Bell, who was doing the overnight shift, and have Bud sign it back on sometime after midnight.
Have you won $20 in the WFLI telephone contest?
You can, you know, by just dialing 1070.
Dial 1070 is the WFLI keyword.
If we call you and you know dial 1070 is the keyword, you may win $20.
We'll be calling you soon.
Pepsi Cola hits the spot. 12 full ounces, that's a lot. Twice as much for a nickel, too. Pepsi Cola is the drink for you.
The most requested songs on WFLI in 1966.
One, two, three.
Good luck. Good luck.
We can work it out. We can work it out. Think of what you're saying. You can get it wrong and still you think that it's all right.
Hot town, summer in the city. Back of my neck getting dirt and gritty. Bend down, isn't it a pity? Seem to be a shadow in the city.
Good Vibrations was just something that came up out of our subconscious or group consciousness. Brian's always been uncannily timely in that respect with his music and with his feelings.
I love the colorful clothes you wear and the way the sunlight plays upon her hair.
Sunny. Yesterday, my life was filled with rain.
One of the most successful advertising campaigns in Chattanooga's rich radio history was born in the WFLI production room. Johnny Eagle explained.
Stanley Hall and I did all of the Wiley Mobile Home commercials. He wanted to be different, and he wanted to be country because he felt like they were selling to a country audience. To someone who Stanley, I think, was really the one that come up with Lukey and Hoss. And he was Hoss and I was Lukey. And that's how that started. Later on, we brought in Joe Poteet as Cousin Jay Fred to just continue to add spice to it. And even Neil Miller, bless his heart, he played a role. he played a role in that, and you know, if he gets involved in it, it's going to be funny. And when he was involved, it would take us forever to get through a commercial because he would just crack you up every time he turned around.
Neil Miller was one of the funniest people in Chattanooga.
I don't know why in the world talented. That man didn't become a comedian. He really was. I mean, but you could hear him coming before you saw him.
Carefree economy from which you'll never roam.
Live the life of Wiley in a Wiley's mobile home.
Hawks, where's Tiz you going?
Wiley Trailer Sales, 5319 Ringgold Road, and sit under the shade tree and drink water out in the gourd.
I thought they had mobile homes over there.
They got mobile homes out there. For instance, a 1962 52-by-10-foot, three-bedroom mobile home for only $39.95.
Only $39.95?
That's right, and it's completely furnished for what you can set up housekeeping right now. But I prefer to sit under the tree and shoot the breeze.
I believe I would too. See you over there, Hoss.
Thank you now.
For carefree economy from which you'll never roam,
live the life of Wiley in a Wiley's mobile home.
Hoss, you know over at Wiley's at 5319 Ringle Road, you could get a completely furnished mobile home, 42 by 10 foot, two bedroom for only $34.95.
Completely furnished?
Completely furnished.
But what if I don't want one?
Well, you can go on over there and sit in the shade and drink on that well water out of that gourd and chew the fat with the boys over at Wiley's.
Sounds most interesting.
It's at 5319 Ringle Road. See you over there, Hoss.
So cool, so light, so sparkling bright, that's Carling Black Label beer.
If you try it, you'll like it. Brewed in the South by the Carling Brewing Company, Atlanta, Georgia.
Serving greater Chattanooga and the Mid-South from Lookout Mountain, Tennessee, JET-FLI WFLI. And now, on we go with a musical show on Down Beat, 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 Beat.
WFLI's Ron Daly talks about a promotion that went terribly wrong.
So there was a competitor in town,
right,
that had a Tiger Radio.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's,
oh,
that's a time in life when all the gasoline companies were saying, put a Tiger in your tank. And they had tied in with Tiger Radio. So Mr. Benz, the owner of WFLI, put out the challenge to the DJs of come up with something to knock that Tiger Radio in the head. Just come out with something big. And then Dale hit on this idea of leader the JET-FLI line. And we had a slogan saying that the lion is king of the jungle and JET-FLI is king of the cats. Remember
yeah,
that?
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah. And we called the line, we named her leader. The hotline rang and I picked it up and Ron was in tears. He deserves an Academy Award for this performance. I thought he had hit a kid.
He believed it, hook, line, and sinker.
I thought he had hit a kid. He said, oh, man, he said, something terrible's happened. He said, you won't believe it. I said, what, Ron? What's happened? He said, you won't believe it. Mr. Ben's going to fire me. I know he will. I said, what has happened? I like never got him to tell me. He said, the leader of the line has gotten out. I've gotten traffic backed up for 10 miles. You know,
downtown Chattanooga Market Street, and every policeman in the world came down. This promotion had been planned. Stanley Hall was in on it. The late Bill Warren was in on it. And a couple of the other guys had a little bit of an inkling of what we were going to do, but we had no idea that it would mushroom the way it did. We wanted to say that we had lost the line and that he was out and create some attention with that, but we never thought about when we planned the promotion that all the police in the world would come down on motorcycles and that they might even throw us in jail behind cold bars if they figured out who put that promotion together. So we didn't tell anybody it was a promotion for a long time. The lion supposedly escaped from the car. They brought bloodhounds down. This really happened on Market Street
from Cleveland, Tennessee,
to try to find the lion.
It was what?
St. Bernard.
Yeah, and St. Bernard's too.
Then on top of that, anybody that had a cat around their house, a dog up under the house, started calling the police department thinking that the lion was at their house, and it created quite a lot of havoc and frankly did get the station a lot of publicity and broadcast magazine
and trouble.
Newspaper and could have got some folks put in jail had we known who had done something like that. See, but we didn't tell for a long time, and luckily Mr. Benz didn't fire us. We found the line and all worked out well, and the station got a lot of publicity out of it.
The greatest promotion ever happened.
The line was just tied around the corner anyway.
Where did you hide it? The line was safe and sound.
Where did you hide
it? In the back of a trunk of a friend's car with air. We had it fixed where the lion could breathe and everything.
Yeah. I knew nothing whatsoever about it. Zero. But I wasn't the only one.
Tommy really felt sorry for it.
Yeah,
you know,
Mr. Benz didn't know about it. I don't think Johnny knew about it. it, and he was a program director, so it was very kept very secretly, really.
Ron, how many of you all didn't know what was going on?
There was actually three people that knew exactly. You know, Ben Franklin says two can keep a secret when three of them are dead, so the secret didn't last real long.
The lion was blind in one eye.
Oh. And would jump on anyone that made a move.
Right.
And he was so big, he would knock you across the room.
Yeah.
Sometimes, as a joke, the DJs would let the lion loose in the lobby of the radio station to knock a newcomer over when they...
That was true.
An initiation deal there.
Yeah.
She was that docile? I mean, did you could play with her?
You could play with her.
New person comes on board, and the first thing they got was to feed the lion.
Yeah, this is true.
To clean up after a lion. I don't know if you've ever done that or not.
I have. Mr. Benz and I have done that.
Yeah.
It's not a real pleasant sight.
Well, how long did you keep the character? I mean...
Too long, really.
What about this guy here?
Here we go. Let's get the voice on, Roger.
Yeah, Roger Allen Wade. Roger Allen and I met when I started the Tommy Jet Entertainers reunions way back when his hair was a little bit longer.
Oh, yeah, that looked
thicker. Mine was a little thicker, too. Mine was a little thicker.
You still look good, man.
Yeah, well, I don't know about that, but this is super talent right here, ladies and gentlemen. Not only a great voice, but a great person in my opinion.
Well, you can't shake Tommy Jet off of Chattanooga in this area. You know, my memories of my youth, laying there at night and you thought nobody else in the world cared about you, or even, you know, everybody's looking right through you and nobody would give you the time of day, man, but you could always look up in the sky and you knew TJ loved you.
Well,
and there ain't nothing, Tommy Jet's one of my heroes, always has been, always will be.
I appreciate it.
And we got time for, I got you in a song, man.
I grew up
on the streets of Brainerd, and...
I was hoping you'd sing that song.
If you've got time for it, I'd love to do it for you.
We got the time. We're going to make the time
for you.
This is for my hero, Tommy Jet. Yeah, we were suicide pirates on asphalt seas. We burned a quarter mile in 9.3. Driving bored out stallions armored in chrome. It was winner take all and loser walk home. Sometimes it got so hot them pink slips glowed down on the Rainerd Road. We parked them cars when we got done racing. Crank up out on our rock and roll station. I'd run my fingers through your long dark hair. We'd fly with the fastest jet in the air. Till Will Ward would come and he'd run us home down on the Rainerd Road. United is glory, glory, hallelujah. I hope it don't explode. I got me a 454, both feet flat on the floor and roaring.
Hello, I'm Johnny Eagle, and you're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years.
In the national news on WFLI in 1967, three Apollo astronauts are killed in their spacecraft during a simulated launch. Israeli and Arab forces battle. The Six-Day War ends with Israel occupying the Sinai Peninsula, the Golan Heights, Gaza Strip, and the East Bank of the Suez Canal. Red China announces the explosion of its first hydrogen bomb. Thurgood Marshall becomes the first black U.S. Supreme Court Justice, and Dr. Christian Barnard and a team of U.S. South African surgeons perform the world's first successful human heart transplant. One of the biggest news stories on WFLI in 1967 was the Peerless Woolen Mills fire. It was one of the largest in Chattanooga's and the nation's history.
Hi, everybody. This is Gene Levin, and you're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years.
What you are.
WFLI's late Ray Anderson.
Oh, I'll never forget the WFLI days. It was, as Ron was saying a while ago, it was so much fun. And I can sit, and you can ask my wife, I can sit and talk about the WFLI days for all night long and never even get sleepy. it's like Ron said, we could do what we wanted to. There was no rules. There was no no one governed what you wanted to do. If the production room was open, you were entitled to it. And no one cared if you were in there all night or... in fact, I've been run out of the production room early in the morning. I've gotten there at 5 o'clock in the morning and be run out at 7 o'clock by Swoopin' Eagle because he had stuff that had to go on the air. A lot of times I would produce things that I would take and play for my client, and it softened the sale so much because they wanted this. They could hear it on the air. And Mr. Benz, he's a genius when it comes to getting the most a person has got in his soul. If you work for Billy, he'll get it right out of your heart, right out of your soul, and it has made it fun and enjoyable, and it was every day was fun.
The WFLI traffic signal is now yellow. Roads are wet and dangerous in the Chattanooga area. Drive with care.
Pepsi Cola hits the spot. 12 full ounces, that's a lot. Twice as much for a nickel, too. Pepsi Cola is the drink for you.
McCrory's in the Bryman Shopping Center in Dalton, Georgia, wishes to thank you for the terrific turnout at their grand opening yesterday. And to do this, they're showing their appreciation with bargains such as these. Girls' back-to-school dresses, regularly $3.99, only $2.97. A wide selection of prints, solids, and plaids, only $2.97. Sizes 3 to 6X and 7 to 14. Girls' Orlon cardigan sweaters, $1.97, in sizes 7 to 14 in the newest fall colors. Save every day, always at McCrory's.
Serving greater Chattanooga and the Mid-South from Lookout Mountain, Tennessee, JET-FLI WFLI. And now, on we go with a musical show on Down Beat, 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 Beat.
The number one requested song on WFLI in 1967, by far, goes to The Doors.
You know that it would be untrue.
I'm Ben Cagle, and you're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years. The groundbreaking DJs of WFLI influenced a lot of others. Others who would follow with their own dream of a job at WFLI. WFLI's David Carroll remembers meeting Tommy Jett for the first time.
I had never met Tommy Jett. I'd heard him, heard about him all my life, listened to him when I was a kid. When I started listening to Fly, Tommy was on weekends, and he certainly stood out from the pack even then with his style. But I'd never met him, and by the time I started working there, 4 or 5 years later, Tommy had moved on, and he was something of a legend in that building. All of us there knew of him, but didn't really know Tommy. One night, I was getting off at midnight, and Greg Reed was coming on, and I was sitting around talking to him, and the doors opened, and Mr. Benz came in, and he was very unhappy, and we're still not sure why, but he was extremely angry about something, and came in and started yelling at me and started yelling at Greg, and we need to start playing more Elvis music. And it was really kind of frightening. He was very upset, and, you know, maybe Dale Anthony had done something to make him mad that day. That would happen from time to time, too. But Greg and I were, you know, both around 19, 20 years old, and our station manager was our owner, was very upset with us. And honest to goodness, you see these scenes in movies where something miraculous happens, you know, someone, an angel appears from afar. Tommy Jett, about 12:30 in the morning, by this time he was working at WDOD, he had just gotten off work and for whatever reason chose that night to come back to the station just to visit and see his old haunts. You know, he used to have a room there. And that night, the night that Mr. Benz was angry, Tommy Jett walked in the building. Greg and I had never met Tommy, but what I can tell you is, at that moment, Mr. Benz went from angry to happy. He gave Tommy a hug. Welcome back, Tommy Jett. You're the best there ever was. You're a legend. You're one of the all-time greats. You're amazing. And, of course, Tommy hugged Mr. Benz, too. But I'll never forget how that changed Mr. Benz's mood and how just the sight of Tommy Jett transformed him from whatever bad mood he was in to being very happy. And now that I do know Tommy well, I'll tell you he has that same effect on me. Every time I see him, it makes me happy.
The most requested songs on WFLI in 1967.
Give me a ticket for an aeroplane. Ain't got time to take a fast train. Lonely days are gone, I'm a-going home. My baby just wrote me a letter. Then I saw her face. Now I'm a believer. Not a trace of doubt in my mind. I've been alone. I'm a believer. I couldn't leave her if I tried.
I can't see me loving nobody but you for all my life.
Eagle, and you're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years.
Good sense, ill sense, crippling mankind.
It's 21 minutes past 1 o'clock from Big WFLI 73. The winds are southeast at 4 miles an hour. Tommy Jet hit 3 this afternoon. This is the Everly Brothers. Remember this one? Gonna walk right back. You know, you're ready to go out on a great rock concert, but there's gonna be a lot of real heavy sounds like the one you just heard. You're looking and feeling real good, but as you leave, just for a second, a thought flashes through your head. Oh, wow. I wish I had better skin. Well, a lot of people your age feel that way, you know. You're not alone. But now, there's a great product for you. It's called Proper pH. Proper pH really helps relieve acne, pimples, and blackheads. Proper pH was created by a pharmacist for his own kids. So you can be assured a lot of thought has gone into it. You know you can have confidence in it because Proper pH is clear and colorless. Nobody can tell you're using it, which is the way it should be. We know, and you know, there are a lot of skin care products on the market. Now, we happen to think ours is the best. In fact, you use it for 3 days or more, and if you're not completely satisfied with it, Proper pH will refund your money with no questions asked. Now, you can't beat a deal like that. So pick up on Proper pH lotion right away and get heavy with the rest of the game.
Calling all race fans. Today is the day for the big race at Boyd Speedway, where you can see NASCAR racing for only $1. You are going to see one of the most fun-filled races of the year when the green flag falls on the Sportsman Division races, where anything and everything can and does happen. You will see such stars as Jolie Johnson, Freddie Fryer, and Tootle Estes, and many, many more. You will also see a lot of top rookies who are going to make things pop. So get your friends together and be at Boyd Speedway for an afternoon of fun and thrills. First race is at 2:30. I'll see you there.
The WFLI traffic signal is now yellow. Roads are wet and dangerous in the Chattanooga area. Drive with care.
Here's part of an interview from 1988. The late J. Fred Poteet, WFLI's chief engineer, talks about one of the many practical jokes. This time, the joke was on Tommy.
Stanley would get down under the production room, down under the console, and take a coat hanger and trigger the cart machine that had this message on it, and it come blasting over the air monitor, WKDA's weather and WKDA time and all that. So Tommy jumps up and runs and grabs him, and the engineer says, "Hey, there's something wrong. WKDA is coming over the air monitor." He says, "It can't be." He said, "But it is. And by the way, everybody was in on this joke except Tommy. I mean, even the girls in the office." And so he drags this engineer in there, and it comes blasting over there monitoring. He said, "Did you hear it?" And he says, "Hear what?" He said, "You mean you didn't hear that?" And he said, "No." He said, "There it comes again. It's WKDA time." And he said, "No, I don't hear anything, Tommy. All I hear is what you're playing." And he says, well, I know I heard something. So he goes and gets him another engineer and brings him in there, and he tells him he can't hear it. And he goes and gets the girls out of the office, and they say, no, Tommy, there's nothing to come across that. And after a while, see, this goes on for 2 weeks. And Tommy gets real serious, and he seen Mr. Benz, and he told Mr. Benz, says, look, Mr. Benz, I'm going to have to quit. And Mr. Benz says, what's wrong, Tommy? I thought you liked your job. He said, oh, I do. I love it. But he said, be honest with you, he said, I'm cracking up. He said, I'm hearing things.
It's true.
Did you really?
It's a true story. Really,
Tommy was afraid to go to the drive-in theater and get the speaker in the car. He thought he was hearing it on it, too. And he told Mr. Benz, he said, I'm cracking up. I'm going over to Mox and Ben, turn myself in. Mr. Benz says, now you just hold on here. He says, somebody's pulling your leg. He said, I'll find out who it is. I'll fire him. And so Tommy come back and told me, and I seen he was suffering, and I began begging the guys to quit doing it. And, of course, I wasn't going to blow the whistle on him. He got me in there one day, and I got tickled, and he said, uh-huh, you heard it, didn't you? I said, no, Tommy, what are you trying to pull on me? So finally, we talked Stanley into leaving the cart out. Tommy grab up every cart and stick it in the machine and audition it. And so finally, he left that cart out. And it said the KDA weather and all that. And Tommy said, boy. He said, you don't know how good it feels to think you're crazy and find out you're not.
Power of suggestion. Power of suggestion can do a lot, really.
Well, you had some, you had how many people?
Everybody, but me was in on it, and they were coming. You know, I thought I was sharing.
Well, you were in on it, Tommy. You just didn't know
it. I didn't know it. I didn't know I was in on it, but I was.
WFLI's Bill Miller.
I came to JET-FLI when I was 18 years old, and I was talking to Dale Anthony one day. Dale did the mornings, and he was about 28 at the time. And Luther was over at WDEF. Luther had about 50% of the audience against Dale, and I asked Dale one day, Doc, how in the world are you going to beat Luther? What's your strategy for beating Luther? And he said, well, honey, I'm 28 years old, and Luther is in his 50s. Sooner or later, Luther's going to retire. And when he does, I'm going to be right here waiting on him, waiting on that audience. And my first job was to do weekends, to do 12 to 6 on Sunday afternoons, including the countdown of the Flying 20, the countdown show. And on the air at the time, we had Dale Anthony did mornings, Dr. Dale. From 9 to noon, it was Ringo Van. Noon to 3, Nick Smith. Mike Murray did the Mike Murray go round from the, in the afternoon from 3 to 6 p.m., and then Ringo Van came back and did a show from 6 to 9. Tommy Jett came in at 9, and he went to, I think, 1 o'clock in the morning, either 9 to midnight or 9 to 1 o'clock in the morning, which would have included the night train show. And Barry Jansen, Barry J., did the overnight show.
In the national news on WFLI in 1968, North Korea seizes the U.S. Navy ship Pueblo and holds 83 on board as spies. North Vietnamese launched the Tet Offensive, a turning point in the Vietnam War. Lyndon Johnson announces that he will not seek re-election.
It is true that a house divided against itself is a house that cannot stand. Accordingly, I shall not seek and I will not accept the nomination of my party for another term as your president.
Tragedy struck America, April 4th, 1968.
America tonight is ashamed. Again, an assassin has struck down a man who wanted only peace and nonviolence. Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. is dead.
2 months later, tragedy struck again.
The doctors now on the scene, trying to see what they can do. Now here are Kennedy aides moving.
Sadly, Robert F. Kennedy would die only hours later.
Serving greater Chattanooga and the Mid-South from Lookout Mountain, Tennessee, JET-FLI WFLI. And now on we go with a musical show on Down Beat, 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 Beat.
Thank you.
the most requested song on WFLI in 1968. WFLI's chief engineer, the late Joe Poteet.
I know you remember. Tommy, who did the record Lost? Was that one of Ray Stevens?
No. I don't know who it was, Joe.
Anyhow, Chris got the record, and he dubbed off on...
Was that the one I can't hear you, man? I got a
crack
in my ear. Oh, yeah, I remember the record, but I don't know who did it.
Well, anyhow, Chris dubbed off that part, says, hey, man, you got a cricket in your ear. He said, huh? He says, you got a cricket in your ear. He said, man, I can't hear you. I got a cricket in my ear.
Yeah.
Well, we all had name promos then that we put on the air about every 30 minutes. Tommy, he liked to play his about every 15. If they wasn't watching him, he'd slip it in. So he comes in and he drags his chair up and he reaches up and gets his name promo to let him know that the great Tommy Jett's here on the air. He's broadcasting to the whole world. And he sticks that in there, and what the promo it was supposed to say was, this is Tommy Jett, WFLI, now on we go with more...
Musical show.
With a musical show with more music on downbeat, beat, beat, beat. And so that's what he thought was going to come out. And when he hit the button, it says, hey, man, you got a cricket in your ear. He said, huh? He said, you got a cricket in your ear. He said, man, I can't hear you. I got a cricket in my ear. So Tommy, he could just imagine everybody knew he goofed, and he grabs that cart out and reaches up and gets everybody else's name promo and goes and erases everybody. So that put an end to her name promo.
That when I first started WFLI, my name was not Tommy Jett. Obviously, pseudonyms.
It still
isn't. Thank you, Johnny. I appreciate that. Now, but we all had pseudonyms, including Mr. Eagle back here. I could tell you his real name. Anyway, Tom Wayne was my original air name at the time. And when you first got hired at WFLI, your name was A. Naughty Moose, which is a derivative of Anonymous, to see how you're going to work out, see if you're going to be around for any length of time, you know. So when I first went on, it was A. Naughty Moose. Then it got to be Tom Wayne, which was an air name that I had drummed up myself, Tom Wayne. So for about 2 weeks, I had on my car Tom Wayne, and it was Tom Wayne. Well, Tom Wayne wasn't catching on too well, really. The next guy that was to be hired, his name was to be Jimmy Jett. Mr. Benz and I had already met and had been out a few times.
Now, by Mr. Benz, you mean?
The owner of the station. The owner of the radio station, the man who is responsible for this whole thing. As he'd gotten used to calling me Tommy. So one night he and Johnny were in the production room. I was on the air as Tom Wayne. And like I said, Tom Wayne really wasn't catching on all that well. And so Johnny motioned me to come over to the production room. And I went over there. And Johnny said, Tommy, it's time to change your name. We're going to change it to Jimmy Jett. And I said, well, that's fine. That's great with me. You know, I was happy with anything. And Mr. Ben said, oh, no. So we're going to make his name Tommy Jett. I'm used to calling him Tommy, and we're going to make his name Tommy Jett. So for what it's worth, if it hadn't been for Mr. Billy Benz, there would be no Tommy Jett. So it's been great for me, and I love Mr. Benz, and like Johnny, I know, would say, if it hadn't been for Mr. Benz, there'd be no Tommy Jett, there'd be no Johnny Eagle, there would have been no Ron Daly, no Mike King, no Dale Anthony. So, you know, we just want to pay a great deal of respect and appreciation to Mr. Benz for all he's done for all of us, because he laid the groundwork for all of our careers.
Some of the most requested songs on WFLI in 1968.
Jesus loves you more than you will know. Whoa, whoa, whoa. God bless you, please, Mrs. Robinson.
Sitting in the morning sun,
I'll be sitting when the evening comes, watching the ships roll in, and then I'll watch them roll away again. Yeah, I'm sitting on the dock of the bay. Young girl, get out of my mind.
To reminisce, a great gold record hit at WFLI.
Okay, then let's move over quickly to Ringo McVan.
Yeah, McVan.
Ringo Van. Tell us a little bit about how you came about JET-FLI.
Well, I remember the day, as maybe we all do. Johnny probably doesn't. I'm sure he doesn't remember it, but yeah. I'd come to the university, what was then the University of Chattanooga. It was about this time of the year, 1964. It was late August, early September, 1964. Working my way through school, I needed a job. And my uncle, who had a station in South Pittsburgh, WEPG, and he had called Luke Wilson over at WDEF,
yeah.
or DXB.
He was
the manager over there.
Right.
And he had called Luke and said, my nephew is looking for a radio job, and he's done some work for me, and he'll make you a good weekend guy. So I went down there and did an audition with Jerry Linger, who was then, I guess, the program director. Jerry Linger felt
yeah,
on the air. He was
Jerry Linger.
Jerry Linger.
He just lingered on the air.
And he said, I don't have any. We've already got a weekend guy, Doug Hollander, from Abson around here. And he said, let me call over at WFLI. I'd never heard of WFLI. I was coming from Suwanee, Tennessee, and we didn't go that far.
No,
we didn't go in that direction either.
And Jerry Linger came back and he said, they've got a weekend spot available. Charlie Darr, who was the weekend guy, had just gone off to the University of Alabama.
That's right.
And come on out there and do an audition. So I hitchhiked around the mountain. I'd walked down to the Dome building from the campus. Hitchhiked around the mountain. This was before I-24 was there. Yeah. I said,
no freeways.
And got down to Browns Ferry Road and trying to find O'Grady Drive, you know, and I went in and we did an audition, and the rest is history. Five years I was there.
And I got sick, and you got three months on the air.
Right. I was working Sundays and then Saturday Sundays initially, and did that for a long time, then a lot of fill-ins.
Yeah, yeah. So
thanks to this guy here.
Right, and the red jacket.
He did a good job, too.
Yeah, he did. He did a phenomenal job. And I've got pictures of him in the lobby of the radio station with Bermuda shorts and a sling blade in his hand.
He cut the grass between records.
I know. You did do some...
Anything to make a dollar, you know.
20 after 6 WFLI Super Summer Spectacular Time, partly cloudy, 93 degrees.
With the most music in the Mid-South, it's
WFLI.
JET-FLI presents the Sound of Music with Ringo Van.
WFLI Music Power.
6:23 on a Sunday night as we wind up a wonderful weekend at WFLI. Here's a mighty, mighty pretty recording by Henry Mancini, orchestra, chorus, and the love theme from Romeo and Juliet.
WFLI, traffic signal, green, 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 green.
6:25, Sunday night, winding up a wonderful weekend at WFLI Radio. Here's Donovan and Atlantis.
Now, JET-FLI presents Today
and Yesterday.
Twin spin.
6:33, most music time with Ringo.
WFLI. Music coming on strong.
Lay it on me, Leon. These are the Archies from the Fly Flying 20 survey.
Sugar.
Those are the Archies. Sugar, sugar. 24 minutes till 7 at WFLI Radio with Ringo Van the Music Man. Partly cloudy to clear and hot weather tonight and tomorrow, with a slight chance of mostly evening thunder showers through Monday. The high today was 93, the low tonight 70. The high tomorrow will be 95, and it's 93 degrees right now. Neon Philharmonic. Good morning, girl. How'd you sleep last night?
Morning, girl.
I just received some very kind words from some very dear friends of mine over the Normandy Apartments in Chattanooga. Certainly do appreciate that, gang, more than you know. Thank you very much. Gotta be one of the greatest songs this group has ever recorded. Junior Walker, the All-Stars, and honey, what does it take to win your love?
WFLI.
They froze Coca-Cola.
Who did?
The Coca-Cola Company.
Well, who had a better right?
It's not a question of right.
I know your type. You're a troublemaker. Did you know they froze Coca-Cola?
Yeah.
You did know it?
Yeah.
Well, why didn't you tell me?
I didn't want to get involved.
They froze Coca-Cola. And now we have frozen Coca-Cola. The drink you eat. With a spoon. Or a straw. You'll eat it up. Frozen Coca-Cola.
Hey, Archie, my sweet patootie. Pootsie pootsie.
What do you want, Mabel?
Let's have a party this weekend.
Honey, you know we can't afford it.
But, Archie, the Beverage Barn has discount beer prices. They've got everything we'll need for a great party.
Well, all right, Mabel. But there's just one thing. This time, I get to cut down the neighbor's tree.
Well, okay.
The Beverage Barn, 2300 Cannon Street, just off Rossville Boulevard.
Hi, this is Niccolo Niccolo, the JET-FLI Lookout Mountaineer, and you're listening to JET-FLI, the early years.
Chattanooga veteran broadcaster Earl Freudenberg remembers the high school days.
I never worked at WFLI, but I certainly spent a lot of time listening to the station. Growing up, it was WDXB and WOGA. They were top 40, all the great top 40 artists. But then in the early 60s, WFLI sound on the air, and it's like walking into the room, turning on a light.
Little GTO, you're really looking fine. Three deuces and a four-speed.
Kids my age switched over to WFLI. I wonder if Dixby and Uga had any listeners left, although they were still doing some top 40. But at Kirkman High School, all the kids started listening to WFLI, and the GTO and the Mustang, those were the two popular cars. And although I didn't have a car in high school, a lot of the guys did, and plenty of girls chasing after them. But in the afternoon when school was over, why, you could go to the parking lot, and I remember a couple of guys had convertibles. And it was just like stereo or ultra high fidelity. Everybody was listening to WFLI.
In the national news on WFLI in 1969.
The Eagle has landed. I'm going to step off the land now. It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
President Nixon begins Vietnamization in Southeast Asia. The United States, USSR, and 100 other countries sign the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. Senator Edward Kennedy pleads guilty to leaving the scene of a fatal accident at Chappaquiddick.
This is now made public, and as it should be, and the ultimate decision will be with the public, as it should be.
In 1969, more than 500,000 people gathered in the small upstate New York town of Bethel, near Woodstock.
This is the largest group of people ever assembled in one place, but
have proven something to the world, that a 500,000 kids can get together and have 3 days of fun and music, and have nothing but fun and music.
Hi, everybody, this is Gene Lovin, and you're listening to the history of WFLI, the early years.
The most requested song on WFLI in 1969 goes to the Stones.
I met a gentle ballroom queen in Memphis.
Tommy Jett talks about breaking the format on the Night Train.
Well, the reason it was so popular is, like Ray said, it was a non-formatted program. It was, back then, WFLI was formatted, very strictly formatted. This was an hour where we could kind of, the disc jockey kind of let their hair down a little bit. We talked a little bit more. I had a thing where I would go by Rossville and pick up Joe and Betty Sue and put them in the lover's car, and I had a little thing that I would toot, which was the Night Train horn. And it just really caught on. I've still got several of the tapes with Ray on them and Billy Warren and Bud Bell, and Joe
Tommy's
used to help with it.
Still tooting his own horn.
I'm still tooting my own horn, because, see, I still make a living. Let me say this. I still make a living. These guys are not in radio. That's how I still pay my bills. These guys don't do that anymore, except Johnny.
Tommy, would you do that station?
Okay, I'll do the station.
Tell me about it before you do it now.
Well, you tell him, Ron.
But we had a station ID that became quite famous that actually another DJ recorded from another sister station of WFLI, but Tommy was one of the all-time greats of giving the station ID.
And I don't know how good I'll be at it tonight. I can remember the words to it, but it went something like this. Serving Greater Chattanooga and the Mid-South from Lookout Mountain, Tennessee, JET-FLI WFLI.
All right.
Hey, I like that shot.
Now, on we go with a musical show on Down Beat, 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 Beat.
It's great gold record time again.
Yeah, that's how it went.
You guys are remembering.
Oh, I'd never forget it, you know.
Hello.
Good morning, madam. This is your service auto parts answer man, and I'm here to answer all your automotive questions.
Who is this? Is this you, Harry?
My first answer. No, this is not Harry. Now for another answer. Yes, service auto parts on Lee Highway is Chattanooga's largest auto parts store.
I didn't know that.
Live and learn, lady, and they are across from Lowe's on Lee Highway. And they are open every night till 9, and Sundays noon till 6.
Wouldn't it be easier for you to just advertise on the radio?
What an idea.
The WFLI traffic signal is now yellow. Roads are wet and dangerous in the Chattanooga area. Drive with care.
The most requested songs on WFLI in 1969.
With hair, long, beautiful hair, shining, gleaming, streaming, flaxing, waxing. Give me down to there.
And this is the dawning of the age of Aquarius. Age of Aquarius.
In the year 3535, ain't gonna need to tell the truth. Tell no lies. Everything you think, do, and say is in the pill you took today.
We can't go on together with suspicious minds.
Lay, lady, lay, lay across my big breast bed.
WFLI's David Carroll.
We had a fun staff of disc jockeys back then, guys who liked to party and have a good time and enjoy all the things that the life of a disc jockey can bring. We had a great guy named Rich Phillips who was just, you know, all personality and a lot of fun. And Rich loved the ladies, and the ladies loved Rich. And we were all doing some kind of promotion at the station one evening, and Mr. Benz happened to be there, and he felt like Rich was a little too flirty with some of the young ladies. And so, for whatever reason, that offended Mr. Benz, and he said, Mr. Phillips, you're fired. And Rich is what? You're fired. Don't come back. You're done. Pick up your stuff. Take it home. And we all, you know, for a moment, were kind of stunned by that. So the next day, you know, Rich called and said, you fellas, I'm fired. What do I do? And the program director at the time, Merv Pilgrim, said, come on in. It'll be okay. And so the next day, Rich came back to work just like nothing happened. And this became a habit. We learned over the years that sometimes when you got fired, you could come back the next day and he'd forget. So that was actually, you know, pretty good job security.
WFLI's Johnny Eagle.
I'm driving downtown, right?
Topographical era.
And I'm listening to Tommy do the news. And he does the news about this gentleman got hit downtown. And he said, this Presbyterian got hit downtown.
I did. This happened.
On Broad Street or whatever, where it was. And I went to a phone booth and called him up and said, Tommy, how did you know that man's religion? Did it tell the religion on the story?
Pedestrian. That's a true story. Pedestrian. Yeah, that actually happened.
That was really an eyeballographical area.
Was that what it was? Yeah. Thank you, Ray.
Radio was crazy then. It was really crazy. A lot of fun.
We got a call of a bomb threat. I lived at WFLI, so did Ron. Matter of fact, I moved in when Ron moved out.
Well, and the rent was the right price.
The rent was real cheap. The rent was real cheap.
I want to know when he moved in, before or after the bomb.
Yeah, and Dale was on the air, and so we got a bomb threat. So if you play Sugar Shack, we've got a bomb that we're going to blow up the place. So Dale played Sugar Shack, and they evacuated the building. And I was left in. They forgot that I was in there. And so I got up and stuck with Jackie.
Let me add a little bit to this. He played the record because some person accused him of having a code that when this record was played, it meant something to somebody special to the other person.
Right, yeah.
So what happened was Dale didn't tell me he'd got the bomb threat call. I came on after Dale. This guy called me back thinking I'm Dale Anthony. He says, I warned you once. I'm going to blow you up now. And so I called the police and the sheriff's department. They headed out there. Tommy didn't know he got stranded in the building. It was crazy.
Yeah, it was. And I stuck my head out the door, and they said, it's a bomb threat. And I thought they were kidding me, you know, because they did that quite frequently. And sure enough, it was photographers and...
Tommy?
Yeah.
You?
Yeah, they kidded. And so sure enough, there was a bomb threat, and they had forgotten that I was in there. The building had been evacuated. I was the only one in there. So if there'd been a bomb threat, poof.
WFLI's Max O'Brien.
Every afternoon at 5:25, we used to hit Howard Cosell with a live 30-second spot. So I was about halfway through the spot that day, and it was hot in the radio station, and I had the control room door propped open. It seemed like it was Jim Perkle out in the hallway, and they were talking pretty loud, and I'm trying to read this live spot into Howard Cosell, and I just stopped right in the middle, and I said, hey, we're trying to do a radio show in here. I can't repeat what the response was, but I learned to keep the control room door shut after that.
WFLI's Gene Lovin.
One of the things that I remember is weekly music meetings, and I was privileged enough to be involved with those with Johnny. One of Mr. Ben's sons went to Georgia Tech, and of course, the influences of the Atlanta radio market was... You know, you could tell there was a big influence because it seemed like whatever they were playing in Atlanta, we would end up playing at JET-FLI. So we were always in tune with the latest and the greatest hits.
Rolling.
Tommy Jett's thoughts on the late Billy Benz, owner of WFLI.
and it was all because of Mr. Benz and a vision that he had. And actually, WFLI was a piece of luck, really. He and Bill Brennan didn't think that they could get the frequency 1070 because two other stations were already on that frequency, one in Birmingham and one in Memphis. And I think both of them were 50,000 watts, and he saw no way that they could do it. So it started out as kind of a joke just to pass time to file for it. And come to find out, the joke became a reality. And in return came JET-FLI, WFLI, according to Mr. Benz and Bill Brennan. Mr. Benz was one of the most knowledgeable people I knew at the time, which I didn't know too many people in broadcasting. But Mr. B was like a father figure to me in the later time, but in the early years, he had a vision of what he wanted to do at WFLI. And the format was very tight. The music was carefully selected, and everything was done according to the way Mr. Benz wanted it done. And fortunately for all of us, he did it right.
I'm Ben Cagle. For those of us that were there, some sounds heard on the radio will always be with us.
Serving Greater Chattanooga and the Mid-South from Lookout Mountain, Tennessee, JET-FLI WFLI. And now on we go with a musical show on Down Beat, 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 Beat.
That unmistakable station ID. It'll remain in our minds always. My thanks to Johnny Eagle, Earl Freudenberg, and David Carroll for their help with this program. My broadcasting brothers of more years than I care to count.
Memories pass between the pages of my mind.
Those magical days from the 1960s, arguably the finest years in rock and roll. Memories return occasionally of WFLI, revived from an old song, conversation, a place in time, or even an old photograph. We remember you, WFLI, as a dear friend as we ushered in adulthood. You are our constant friend and companion. We remember you, WFLI. We remember you so well.
I remember. My dreams come true a few kisses ago. I remember you. You're the one who said I love you too. Yes, I do. Didn't you know? I remember too a distant bell.
Serving Greater Chattanooga and the Mid-South from Lookout Mountain, Tennessee, JET-FLI WFLI.
WFLI 1070 AM, Lookout Mountain, Tennessee, is now signing off. It's been an honor and privilege to serve you, our listeners, all of these 56-plus years. Thanks to you, our listeners, WFLI made Chattanooga broadcast history, and we're proud of that fact. A special thanks to all of you who were there in the very beginning. It was quite a party. On behalf of the WFLI management and employees, both past and present, we bid you all farewell. Long live the great JET-FLI.